This is a poem entitled All Hallows Blessing by Jan Richardson. Who live in the spaces between our breathing, in the corner of our vision, in the hollows of our bones, in the chambers of our heart? Nowhere can they be touched, yet still, how they move us, how they move in us, made from the tissue of memory, like the veil between the worlds that stirs at the merest breath. This night and then is at rest. How they move us. How they move in us. You know who I'm talking about. You do, don't you? Each of us, we know. It's the one who paid attention to what was happening with us at just the right time. The one who told you stories and you knew somehow they were just for you. The one who believed in you and showed you silently how to touch God and hold holiness in the palm of your hand. I was 14, and I'd been hearing adults pray in church so long that it just seemed like what adults did when they were called on to lead a meeting or lead a Bible study. But one chilly autumn day, when I was a freshman in high school, brand new at this big school, I had auditioned and made the high school choir with the iconic Charlie Sanders as the conductor. Charlie's choirs for years had filled the Civic Coliseum in Knoxville several times a year with audiences, some who had children in the choirs and others who just loved music. They came about 5,000 every concert to hear his polished high school singers. But in rehearsal, on that cold autumn day with my new loafers and my knee socks for these first days at Central High, Charlie Sanders, oh, there he is, huh? Taught me how to pray. We began rehearsing that gorgeous Paul Mantz anthem entitled, Even So, Lord Jesus, Quickly Come. It was when you could still sing religious music in public school. The text goes like this. Even so, Lord Jesus, quickly come, and night shall be no more. They need no light, nor lamp, nor sun, for Christ will be there all. I watched as he began. And I saw prayer in his face and in his hands, and something gripped me. My breath was taken away, and 14 years old, I sat in rehearsal and wept. And received the gift of connection with God that happens when you pray with your whole body and your voice and your soul. Even though I had a deep, silent prayer life since I can remember, I learned a new prayer language that day, one that brings the spark of God to full flame in my chest. Still. Now, on this All Saints Sunday, we remember and celebrate people like Charlie, who have gone before us in the faith, those who gave our spirits birth and modeled the love of God, and who are with us still in what the Church calls the communion of saints. The theology of the communion of saints is simply this, that those who have died and are now in the presence of God are somehow with us still. They live in those whose lives they've touched. They live in the beauty and good they've expressed in the world. And they worship with us, with the church universal, today and each day. Because we allow for it, I think, that gulf between heaven and earth is easily crossed on this day, as we remember more deeply those who shaped God's will and word within us. Our epistle lesson that you heard earlier says this. This is one testifying to the influence of another. I have heard of your faith in Jesus and your love toward all the saints. And for this reason, I do not cease to give thanks for you as I remember you in my prayers. I pray that God may give you a spirit of wisdom and revelation so that with the eyes of your heart enlightened, you may know what is the hope to which God has called you and what are the riches of the glorious inheritance among the saints and what is the immeasurable greatness of God's love for us. And in our gospel lesson for today, Jesus teaches his followers about how they are to relate to their neighbors, how they are to live in community with one another. This passage, you may have recognized it, is something of a form of the Sermon on the Mount that is in Matthew's gospel, that part that we call the Beatitudes. Luke's version, like Matthew's, begins with God's blessing on those who are poor, or hungry, or sad, or persecuted because of their faith. But then Jesus pulls something of a Jesus-like turn of phrase. He then laments those who are rich and full and laughing and respectable, those who haven't yet encountered the other parts of life, who don't live their lives with kindness and generosity. And finally, he cuts to the quick of what matters with how we live with others. He says we are to love, to bless, to pray for our enemies, to give freely to all who ask of us, to treat others as we wish to be treated. They're Jesus values. The values that shape ethical and inspiring lives like we remember today. They teach us how to understand God, how to be in the world, and how to make our lives matter for others. So in a way, Jesus invites us to remember the saints in our lives who have actually lived this way. Now, they may be religiously virtuous, or they may not. But they are probably those who have lived life fully, mistakes and all, who have loved generously, and who have dared to keep on loving even when life was tough. I may have been 6. My first memories of this are around 8, maybe, I don't remember. But we were on our annual visit with the Mississippi relatives. And then my favorite week of our month-long reunion had finally arrived. We traveled the 25 long country road miles from Anguilla, where my grandparents live. Well, actually, they live 5 miles outside Anguilla, but there wasn't a town, so that we just call it Anguilla. We went through the metropolis of Yazoo City to visit Sis in Holly Bluff. Now, Holly Bluff wasn't much. There was a high school. I remember it had a track because we used to go and run on the track. There was a high school, there was a Baptist church and a Methodist church, and a Black Pentecostal church. And then there was Sis's store. Well, actually, it didn't say Sis's store on the top. It had her real name. Now, you're not going to believe it. Get ready to laugh, but this is the truth. Her real name was across the top. It said, Lurline Screws Store. That was my grandmother's maiden name. I've never heard it since. Sis, my unmarried great aunt on my mother's side, was for this little town of Holly Bluff, the postmaster, the butcher, the gas pump operator, the grocer, and the shoe salesperson. Hers was the only store in the tiny town in the Mississippi Delta. And during the 1950s and 60s, it was the only store at all that served cotton farms for miles. If I was really lucky, which I was on this visit that I remember, I got to spend extra time with Sis all by myself. And I loved it. I loved it because Sis introduced me to all her customers. They seemed to be her friends, too. Glenna, she would say, as she introduced me to those that some people said she shouldn't let try on shoes in her store, or even come through the front door. Glenna, she would say, this is Miss Sophronia. She makes the best fig jam you've ever tasted. And then later on that afternoon, Glenna, come here, I want you to meet Reverend Washington. He's the minister over at Mount Carmel. Maybe we can go hear him preach sometime. And then, when my parents weren't there, we did. We did. My heart opened again and again while I was with Sis. I could spend the whole afternoon telling you stories. Sis was a silent but very intent activist. She honestly didn't care what anyone said to or about her. She treated everyone the same. That is, as friends, with dignity and personal care. She refused to deny service to anyone in her store at a time when the Ku Klux Klan loomed powerfully in that area. Oh, how I learned from her. How to love and include, how to appreciate, how to make equal friends, even if it's in defiance of law or custom. She's with me, well, pretty much all the time, because she birthed something sacred that is part of my body and spirit. How they move us. How they move in us. We may not have known all of those we remember today. We may not have known them well, or we may not have known them all in person. Or they may have been close, a parent or a teacher or a neighbor or a friend. We may have known them for a moment or for a lifetime. But the light of love or grace or attention or insight, the light of the eternal spirit that is love itself shone through them, and through them pierced our souls with tenderness or power and shaped our lives in the image of that love. How they move us. How they move in us. Two of my saints, Saint Charlie and Saint Sis, are here with me. And I know your saints are here with you too. We worship with them and through them and because of them today. Can you feel them? In your memory or in your heart? I invite you to speak their names now. And if after each spoken name, if we could pause for just a second, before we name the next one. We'll do this in prayer. You may speak. Boo Armstrong. than a stapler. For those who walked with us, this is a prayer. For those who have gone ahead, this is a blessing. For those who touched and tended us, who lingered with us while they lived, this is thanksgiving. For those who journey with us still in the shadows of awareness, in the crevices of memory, in the landscape of our dreams, this is a benediction. Amen. Blessed be the saints of light who live and move and have their being in us. Amen. This is a poem entitled All Hallows' Blessing by Jan Richardson. Who live in the spaces between our breathing, in the corner of our vision, in the hollows of our bones, in the chambers of our heart? Nowhere can they be touched, yet still. How they move us. How they move in us. Made from the tissue of memory, like the veil between the worlds that stirs at the merest breath. The one who told you stories and you knew somehow they were just for you. The one who believed in you and showed you silently how to touch God and hold holiness in the palm of your hand. I was 14, and I'd been hearing adults pray in church so long that it just seemed like what adults did when they were called on to lead a meeting or lead a Bible study. But one chilly autumn day, when I was a freshman in high school, brand new at this big school, I had auditioned and made the high school choir with the iconic Charlie Sanders as the conductor. Charlie's choirs for years had filled the Civic Coliseum in Knoxville several times a year with all. This night and then is at rest. How they move us. How they move in us. You know who I'm talking about. You do, don't you? Each of us, we know. It's the one who paid attention to what was happening with us at just the right time.